The Upanishad series, mind is old and useless. Why is this series called Upanishad? Upanishad is an ancient word used for master-disciple communion. It explains the necessary requirement, first of all, the word itself explains the necessary requirement for this communion between the master and disciple. It is intimate. It is out of trust. It is out of love. Why would you like to sit down close to someone if you are antagonistic, if love is not overflowing? You will sit close to someone in a state of loving reverence only if there is trust. Trust brings understanding. Trust is not a relationship. Instead, it is your intrinsic quality. Trust is your intrinsic quality. It is the vehicle that you use to move your inward journey. I'm not talking about belief. I'm not talking about faith. Trust is a totally a different kind of a thing. It is your nature. Just as your breathing, your heartbeat is your intrinsic, your heartbeat is not mine. Your breathing is not mine. So too, trust is your own. Like the heartbeat, like the breathing. Without the breathing, without the heartbeat, your body cannot sustain. So too, without trust, your being cannot sustain. It cannot move forward. It is as natural as is breathing and the heartbeat. So when there is trust, out of that love evolves. And when love comes in, you can come close and you sit down in a state of reverence. In loving reverence, I am not calling it reverence, I am not calling it love. When love evolves out of respect, it has a totally different quality. And then it completes the meaning. Upa is a Sanskrit word meaning sit. Ni means close. And shat is the verb. You are sitting in your living room. All of a sudden a friend comes in. What do you tell him? You tell the friend by signs, come and sit down here. Come and sit down here so that the communication could begin. If the person remains at the door, that means either he is in a hurry or he is antagonistic. He says, no, that's okay. I can remain here. I don't need to come and sit down near you. Only when there is a loving understanding, the person will come and sit near you. The moment he comes and sits near you, the different kind of energy begins to flow. So first of all, and this you do it unconsciously. Someone comes, you just let the person sit even on the couch, which is on the couch next to you. Or if you want to keep on looking at the face of the persons to whom you are talking, then you allow him to sit down in a position where both of you can look at one another. Because when someone is speaking, his countenance, his face says more than what the words communicate. So when the listener is listening, while listening is looking at your face also, through that he is connected to your inner being, and he immediately begins to realize that the words, where these are emanating from. This is the normal way of communication to begin. This is why this particular series is called the Upanishad series. Before I explain why is mind old and why does mind cling to the old always, that which is known. In medical science, specifically in surgery and medicine, the doctors have to diagnose the patient and then prescribe the medicine. They cannot do or give the medicine on the basis of current research that is going on. So in a way, what they practice is based on past experiences, experiments and researches, because they are playing with the life of the person and they do not have the time to go with the current research or tell the patient, you wait, let me do an experiment or research and then I will do the treatment. Mind is always in a hurry. It knows nothing other than the old, and so it clings to the old. Always it clings to the old. But man is consciousness, and this is the reality of the man. However, this reality has not attained its fruition. At the level of the mind, consciousness is thought and thought is borrowed. Mind is not your reality. It is always a false interpretation. You are not the mind. But it is said in modern terminology that as is the mind, so is the man. If you compare your mind with a laptop, it is the RAM, the readily available memory, and the mind works according to that. You are not the mind, you have never been a mind, and you can never be a mind. That is your problem. You have become so much identified with something that you are not, and you do not even know this. You are like a beggar who believes that he has a kingdom. He is so worried about the kingdom because he does not know how to manage or govern it, and also how to prevent anarchy. There is no kingdom, yet he is worried. Mind is just like a crowd of thoughts. Thoughts continue to float on the inner sky, They are like the individuals. And because thoughts are there continuously, you think the process is substantial. Drop each individual thought and finally nothing is left. There is no mind as such. Only thinking, the process remains. If we go or create a parallel with music, the entire process of music is creating the gaps, the peak and the valley. Peaks you see, but valley you go on missing. The gaps between the two notes you go on missing. And if that is not created, then music is incomplete. Between the two thoughts, if you become alert, you are coming in the center. In Vigyan Bhairav Tantra, one of the most ancient treatises on Tantra, Shiva's consort Devi asks certain questions. Instead of giving a philosophical answer to the question, Shiva gives a technique. But in the modern day terminology, someone asks you a question and you give a technique. Everybody wants a ready-made answer. I recall when we were studying, my father used to teach us, if there is a mathematical problem, he will not tell us the right way to do it, this or that. He will try to educe from within you, keep on asking you, and this is what has been the ancient technique of the Upanishads. Teach me that, knowing which everything becomes known. There is a principle behind the binomial theorem. If you know the principle, you can know its application, and you can apply this binomial theorem in anything that you have, any discipline that you are working with. Statistics is a tool. Once you know how to use the tool, you can apply it any discipline. It's like a basic tools that are required in the construction industry, and not only that, in anything that you do. So this is what is necessary. So the prayer goes on, teach me that, knowing which everything becomes known. When you begin to fall between these spaces, the gaps between two thoughts, gap between the two notes, then you begin to understand something deeper. When you look in the intervals, the space in between, you will see that there is no thought. An experiment you can do on Sunday morning, instead of sitting down and watching the television or engaging in something else, at times I will come out of the house and go at the corner, stand at the corner of the road and watch the cars passing. A car passes. There are two lanes or three lanes. A car passes with a noise, blaring music, or silent, or the sound of the speeding of the car. Then there is no car, passing in front of you for a few seconds, maybe minutes or whatsoever it may be, depending at the time of that you are standing or the traffic position. Then all of a sudden the two cars come buzzing in each lane, and this process goes on. From this you can understand the nature of the mind and the stampede of the thoughts. If the cars are continuously driving on the road in all the lanes and even on the shoulder, there will be a chaos. Always there has to be a gap between the two cars. If the cars are running bumper to bumper, that happens when there is a traffic situation. It's a different state. Your mind is like a busy road when the traffic is moving bumper to bumper and there is no space in between. If you would have seen when there is a traffic bumper to bumper, and sometimes it is difficult even to pass through between the cars. And when you begin to fall between, your gestalt begins to change from the movement of the car to the gaps. There is, you can call it no car zone. And this no car zone, when it applies to the mind, it is called no mind. That no mind is your nature. For thoughts come and go because they are accidental. The road is empty. Cars will come and go. Maybe this particular car has passed on this road for the first time in its lifetime. Because the driver of this particular car does not need to come to this road. And when car is not, the road is empty. The thoughts come and go. They are accidental. However, the inner space, the road where the cars move, that always remains. Cloud gather and disappear, but the sky remains. So you have to know whether you are the cloud or the sky. Your identification up to now has been with the clouds, with the thoughts. And these thoughts remain so much like a stampede that they do not allow the space in between for you to move. And because of these, a state of pain and pleasure and other states come to you. You are frustrated because a particular kind of thought is resting and you are not able to throw it out. Wherever you go, your mind is a step ahead of you. It is not only that it follows you like a shadow, it is always one step ahead of you. So it reaches first before you reach there and creates the situation for you to interact in that. It has reached before you. But you are never aware of it because it is so transparent. Whenever you are entering a temple, your mind reaches there before you need. When you are going to a friend and when you embrace him, your mind has already embraced him even before you. And this you can know, your mind is always rehearsing, it goes on rehearsing. Something you have been asked to do, you do a mental rehearsal of that. The spontaneity is lost. That stepping ahead is always rehearsing. Before you speak, it is always rehearsing what to speak. Before you act, it is always rehearsing what to act. And when you are in that empty space, no mind, you do not have to make any effort or research, then it is a spontaneous overflow. There is no technical injunctions of the scriptures. Whatsoever is spoken, it is the outcome of the scripture of the being. What emerges out of the being, and there is no need to do any rehearsal. Before you do anything or you do not do anything, it always goes on rehearsing. The rehearsal means the mind is preparing itself before you. Mind always moves one step ahead of you. And that is a constant, transparent barrier between you and everything else that you will come across, that you will encounter. It is when I was reading the autobiography of Osho, Glimpses of the Golden Childhood. It was the teacher who was concerned that Osho must be brought to the examination hall on his own. He will not come. So he will come and pick him up, and sometimes in night clothes he has to pick him up and drop him in the examination hall and tell the instructor there, do not allow him to go out of the examination hall until the time is over. And his answers were very precise. And he finished in no time. This is the beauty. There is no need to weave around entire philosophy around it. The answers should be terse, straightforward and spontaneous. Rehearsal means mind is preparing itself before you. Mind always moves one step ahead. And that is a constant, transparent barrier between you and everything else that you will come across, that you will encounter. There is a natural reason in it. With the old, one is efficient. With the new, one always feels awkward. You have not learned to live with the new. And that's why you feel so. With the old, you know what to do. With the new, you will have to learn from the beginning afresh. And every time when you learn something, you are creating a new dish, you have to learn how to create it. You have a certain recipes. The recipes get so much stuck in your mind that you do not need to even see and you go into an automated process. With the new you start feeling ignorant. With the old you are knowledgeable. With the old you feel comfortable. You have done something again and again. You can do it mechanically and you need not have any awareness. Even when you are driving, you notice that you are driving mechanically. When your steering wheel steers the vehicle towards your house or the road, observe, are you aware of it or if it happens mechanically? You have done something again and again and you can do it mechanically and you need not have any awareness. With the new, you will have to be alert and aware. Otherwise, something may go wrong. Is a new dish. You have new ingredients to be used. You have to be alert every moment. Have you not washed it? When you learn driving, you are very alert. And when you have learn the art of driving, you forget about it, you sing a song, you listen to the radio, you talk to a friend, you think of 1001 things and still your vehicle continues to drive. Nothing else is needed in that. It just moves. And driving continues as a mechanical process, robot-like, you are not needed. The old becomes mechanical and habitual. With the new comes fear. That is why children are capable of learning. The older you grow, the less is the capacity to learn. You know more. You have accumulated many pebbles, but your capacity to learn diminishes. It is very difficult to teach old dog new tricks. He will repeat the old tricks again and again, the tricks that he knows. Who should take such a bother? It is getting too dangerous. That is why one goes on with the old, something that one has known. But if you live with the old, you are not really living at all. You live only for the sake of the new. With the new is life. Only with the new, and only, I repeat it, only with the new is life. Life has to be fresh. Remain a learner but never become a knower. Remain open but never become closed. Remain ignorant and go on throwing the knowledge that accumulates automatically and naturally. Each day, each moment, free yourself from that you have known and again become a childlike. To become so innocent like a child is the way to live and live abundantly. This is what Jesus had told Nicodemus. When he asked, Master, who can enter the kingdom of your Father? Jesus tells him, one who is childlike. Childlike innocence is of a totally a different quality. Totally different quality. So as a result, the work of the Master is to create a milieu and environment around you. He can create a certain atmosphere, a certain energy field. It is very indirect process, so that you begin to live moment to moment afresh, like a fresh breeze always surging through you. It is just as the gardener prepares the ground, then sows the seeds and then waits. There is nothing else that he can do about it. Now everything depends on the seeds. They will find their way in their own time. It will be something like intuition. The seed lives by intuition. The seed lives by intuition, and we continue to live by the old. I have heard two birds were talking among them. One was crow, crow crows, and it is a shrill. The other bird, in India it is called koel, which almost looks like crow, the same color, same size, but it's when it speaks, it is very melodious sound. So this bird, female bird, asked crow, why you did not marry? The crow answered, even in my unmarried state, I am continuing with the shrill crow sound. So what would have happened if I had married? Even without the marriage, that sound continues. The crow sound is cow cow, crow sound. This is a shrill sound, not a pleasant to the ears. This is the nature of the old, but we are comfortable always with the old. Now, when the seed is planted, everything depends on the seed. The seed will find its way in their own time. It is something like intuition. You cannot persuade the seed to grow faster. You cannot tell them this is the time, go ahead. You cannot order them. You have simply to wait, prepare the ground, remove all the barriers, rocks, weeds, etc. Give them a beautiful bed, watering, sun, and then wait. Then wait for their own intuition to unfold. You cannot do more than that. And that is the function of the master, to create a certain energy field in which your intuition one day suddenly becomes a flame. It cannot be caused, it cannot be forced, it can only be helped. And that too in a passive way. In a passive way. My work is to help you to find where you have lost it, where you have put it, so that you can find it and learn how to open it, and then life becomes a splendor and grandeur of dimensions that are inconceivable. Then for the first time you know what depth means, what height means. Then you are no more flat. Ordinary people are just flat. They do not have any depth or any height, just like flat ground. The real adventure begins only when you start moving deeper into your being, or also higher into the layers of consciousness. And the processes are two sides of the same coin. If you go deeper, you go higher as well, and vice versa. It is one dimension, the vertical. People who are living on a flat life are living horizontally, and their life is just like a flat tire, utterly punctured. No rhythm, no music flows out of it. Remember, mind is own, and it is sum total of thoughts that are borrowed. Just as when the cars are passing on the street, there is a gap in between. That gap is your space that you are looking for. It is your resting place. The moment you start gathering those moments when there is no thought, suddenly something bursts forth, the bliss. And that is what to live by this, each one of you is seeking.